Good morning. Excuse me. Today is the 19th Sunday after Pentecost. We're very pleased to have to be together to worship God, God's holy name. A couple of announcements before we get started. I got a note yesterday that Melba Panghorst has returned to Chicago area, but she fell and broke her foot. So she's out of commission for a bit. Also, a note from Pastor Pfeffer, who is here, and we didn't get it in the bulletin, but on behalf of myself, my sons, and extended family members from 8 states, please accept my heartfelt thanks for a touching funeral service and celebration of life for Karen, my wife of 55 years. Also, we're truly thankful for the members of Grace who provide for refreshments at the wake and the coffee and following the service. We thank you, those who offered prayers, thoughts, gifts to the endowment fund, and any who assisted us in this difficult time. Thank you again and blessings. That's from Pastor Paul and Andrew and Mark and other family members. Are there other prayer requests today besides those listed in the bulletin? Yes. Peg? Okay, thank you. Other prayer requests? Anyone on Zoom have a prayer request? You can just open your mic. Doesn't seem to be. In that case, let's get the children forward, please. Thomas, you're hanging with the young ones now, huh? All right. Let's say the prayer together. Dear Jesus, thank you for loving us. Thank you for our homes. Thank you for our families. Thank you for our church. Thank you for our friends. Please keep us all healthy. Amen. You can go to Sunday school. As you are able, I would invite you to stand this time for the confession and forgiveness. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, God of all mercy and consolation, come to the help of your people, turning us from sin to live for you alone. Give us the power of your Holy Spirit that we may confess our sin, receive your forgiveness, and grow into the fullness of Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen. Let us confess our sin in the presence of God and of one another.
Most merciful God, we confess that we are captive to sin and cannot free ourselves. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us, forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways. To the glory of your holy name. Amen.
In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for us, and for his sake, God forgives us all our sins. As a called and ordained minister of the Church of Christ, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Amen. Thank you. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Let us pray. Beloved God, from you come all things that are good. Lead us by the inspiration of your Spirit to know those things that are right, and by your merciful guidance, help us to do them through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
A reading from Isaiah. Let me sing for my beloved my love song concerning the vineyard. My beloved had a vineyard on a very fertile hill. He dug it and cleared it of stones and planted it with choice vines. He built a watchtower in the midst of it, and he hewed out a wine vat in it. He expected it to yield grapes, but it yielded wild grapes. And now, inhabitants of Jerusalem and people of Judah, judge between me and my vineyard. What more was there to do for my vineyard that I had not done in it? What I expected it to yield grapes, why did it yield wild grapes? And now I will tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will remove its hedge, and it shall be devoured. I will break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will make it a waste. It shall not be pruned or hoed, and it shall be overgrown with briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain upon it. For the vineyards of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the people of Judah are his pleasant planting. He expected justice, but saw bloodshed, righteousness, but heard a cry. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Psalm 80, starting at the 7th verse, read responsively. Restore us, O God of hosts.
Let your face shine upon us, and we shall be saved.
You have brought a vine out of Egypt. You cast out the nations and planted it. You cleared the ground for it. It took root and filled the land. The mountains were covered by its shadow, and the towering cedar trees by its boughs. You stretched out its tendrils to the sea and its branches to the river. Why have you broken down its wall so that all who pass by pluck off its grapes? The wild boar of the forest has ravaged it, and the beasts of the field have grazed upon it. Turn now, O God of hosts, look down from heaven. Behold and tend this vine. Preserve what your right hand has planted.
A reading from St. Paul's letter to the Philippians, the 3rd chapter. Paul writes, "If anyone else has reason to be confident in the flesh, I have more. Circumcised on the 8th day, a member of the people of Israel, of the tribe of Benjamin, a Hebrew born of Hebrews. As to the law, a Pharisee. As to zeal, a persecutor of the church. As to righteousness under the law, blameless. Yet whatever gains I had, these I have come to regard as loss because of Christ. More than that, I regard everything as loss because of the surpassing value of knowing Christ Jesus my Lord. For his sake, I have suffered the loss of all things, and I regard them as rubbish, in order that I may gain Christ and be found in him, not having a righteousness of my own that comes from the law, but one that comes through faith in Christ, the righteousness from God based on faith. I want to know Christ and the power of his resurrection, and the sharing of his sufferings by becoming like him in his death, if somehow I may attain the resurrection from the dead. Not that I have already obtained this or have already reached the goal, but I press on to make it my own, because Christ Jesus has made me his own. Beloved, I do not consider that I have made it my own, but this one thing I do, forgetting what lies behind and straining forward to what lies ahead, I press on toward the goal for the prize of the heavenly call of God in Christ Jesus." Indeed, the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Please remain seated for the reading of the gospel. The Holy Gospel according to St. Matthew, the 21st chapter.
Glory to you, O Lord.
Jesus said to the people, "Listen to another parable. There was a landowner who planted a vineyard, put a fence around it, dug a wine press in it, and built a watchtower. Then he leased it to tenants and went to another country. When the harvest time had come, he sent his slaves to the tenants to collect his produce. But the tenants seized his slaves and beat one, killed another and stoned another. Again, he sent other slaves, more than the first, and they treated them in the same way. Finally, he sent his son to them, saying, "They will respect my son." But when the tenants saw the son, they said to themselves, "This is the heir. Come, let us kill him and get his inheritance." So they seized him, threw him out of the vineyard, and killed him. Now when the owner of the vineyard comes, what will he do to those tenants? They said to him, "He will put those wretches to a miserable death and lease the vineyard to other tenants who will give him the produce at the harvest time." Jesus said to them, "Have you never read in the scriptures, 'The stone that the builders reject has become the cornerstone'? This was the Lord's doing, and it is amazing in our eyes. Therefore, I tell you, the kingdom of God will be taken away from you and given to a people that produces the fruits of the kingdom. The one who falls on this stone will be broken to pieces, and it will crush anyone on whom it falls." When the chief priests and the Pharisees heard his parables, they realized that he was speaking about them. They wanted to arrest him, but they feared the crowds because the crowds regarded Jesus as a prophet. The Gospel of the Lord. Dear sisters and brothers in Christ, I'd like to begin today with a moment of silence as we recognize the bloodshed going on in what we call the Holy Land. Ancient feuds that have yet to be resolved. Join me in silence, please. Gracious and loving God, we pray for all the people of the Mideast, the home of your Son, Jesus. We ask you to bring peace, reconciliation, justice, and compassion to all those, both Jewish and Palestinian, who are caught up in a cycle of violence and war. Let there be peace. Amen. I'm very sensitive today about what's going on over there and the connection to not only today's gospel, written about 2,000 years ago, but today's first lesson and the psalm, written about 3,000 years ago, that describe dynamics that are still playing out today. The psalm has a rather touching and beautiful scene. It has God uprooting the vine, the plant from Egypt, taking it into Palestine and clearing out the land in Palestine of the original inhabitants and planting God's vine, Israel, there in Palestine, in Canaan. We believe, and certainly our Jewish cousins believe, that was very much central to God's acting in the Old Testament to care for God's people. But even when we read the Old Testament and we read about God's movement and leading of God's people from Egypt into the Promised Land, we become aware that the fulfillment of one promise ends up being very, very unhelpful, to say the least, to another whole group of people. It's a reminder to us that there are very few things in the world that are cut and dried, black and white, right or wrong. It's all woven together into the reality of the world that God continues to love passionately. The story of the vineyard, both the one from the Old Testament, or the several from the Old Testament, the one that Jesus tells, is the story of, it's a parable in which God plants this vineyard, Israel, and expects that Israel will grow and prosper, and by its example, show the whole world what it means to live according to the will of God, the teaching, the Torah. And God plants them in Israel and tends them, sends leaders, kings, prophets to help guide their life together, always hoping that Israel will be the best reflection of God's will, not just for Israel, but for all people. And the storyline in the Old Testament is that Israel continues to fall short of God's expectations of them. They are constantly turning their backs on God and on God's law, God's teachings. And instead of being this bright light shining on the hill where everybody around them can say, look how Israel prospers under God's guidance. Instead, everybody around them sees envy and jealousy and hatred and oppression, even in the midst of God's people. And so, according to the psalm, according to the parable that Jesus told, God lets bad things happen to God's beloved people. God sends punishment. God withholds the goodness, the abundance that God had expressed, had promised. And the idea is to try to get them to change their ways and to live up to God's expectations of them. Now, it might be tempting for us as Christians to say, they failed, and now it's our turn. We're the new Israel. We're the new people, society, community, set on a hill for all the world to see. And yet we're no better than Israel. Individually, and corporately, we still turn our backs on God and on God's will. God's will for us and for the rest of the world. We still engage in envy, in jealousy, in all of the sins that we think of as the sins of Israel. This story that Jesus tells reminds us that we are just like Israel. God has chosen us, set us apart from all the people in the world, and raised expectations of us that we would live, that we would show the world what it means to be the beloved people of God. And yet I'm afraid when people who aren't familiar with the church, with Christianity, look at us as a community and say, those folks can't get along at all. Why are Presbyterians and Lutherans not one? Why is the Roman Catholic Church and the Methodist Church not one? Why are we divided? Why are we? Why do we struggle with ourselves and with others to try to live up to God's expectations? We have to confess daily that we individually and corporately have fallen short of God's expectations of us, just like Israel. But, or maybe I should say, and, God does not withdraw God's promises from us because we have failed to live up to those expectations. Just as with Israel, God continues to forgive, to correct, sometimes to punish, to let us experience the consequences of our choices. But God continues to be faithful to us. God will not abandon us, even when it seems that we're trying to abandon God. We believe that God continues to walk with us, continues to work through us, continues to lift us up when we stumble and fall, and set us on the right course again. God continues to encourage us, continues to teach us about grace, about forgiveness, about justice and compassion. God continues to call us. Martin Luther says every morning as you wake up in the morning, you should cross yourself in remembrance of your baptism, reminding yourself, maybe even reminding God, I am a child of God. I go into this day with the intention of carrying out God's work in the world in every moment. Martin Luther also says, at the end of the day, before you go to sleep, make the sign of the cross in remembrance of your baptism, in remembrance of God's promise to you that nothing in all creation will separate you from God's love, not even your own bad choices. God is a God of forgiveness, of second chances, third chances, tenth chances, always new opportunities for us to show who we really are, God's people, forgiven sinners, people with a calling to share with the world this love that we don't deserve, but that we receive in abundance. My intent is not to make all of us feel guilty, although we are. I don't have to slap you in the face and remind you of that. Nor do I need to slap you in the face and remind you that you are forgiven, that you are called again and again and again to get up, to bear fruit that's consistent with who we are, the vineyard lovingly planted by God. Let the fruit that we bear, both as a congregation and as individuals, let that be signs of God's presence, forgiving, reconciling, healing presence in the world, for the world. In Jesus' name, amen.
Let us confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. These are the prayers of the church. Each petition will end, God of grace, with the congregation responding, hear our prayer. Trusting in the transformative power of God's loving Spirit, let us pray for the church, the world, and all in need. God of all grace, you are the source of life and joy. Strengthen the resolve of your church throughout the world, that together we press on toward the goal of your heavenly call in Jesus Christ, God of grace. God of all creation, you plant and nourish the earth as your own precious vineyard. Bless fields and orchards and the hands of those who labor in them, that your people are fed with an abundant harvest of good fruit. God of grace. God of all the earth, you desire peace and justice between nations and peoples. Guide leaders of nations, states, provinces, and cities, that they faithfully govern your people with wisdom, integrity, and compassion. God of grace. God of all compassion, in Christ you lovingly poured yourself out like wine for your people. Have mercy on all who mourn, who struggle with their mental health, who cry out for justice, who hunger, and all in any need, especially Dan, Lois, Betty, Iris, Harmon, Joanne, Linda, Darlene, Lori, Jane, Gloria, Lynn, Mary Jo, John and Jackie, Terry, Arlene, Sue, Pam, Landon, Alice, Carl and Bev, Eleanor, Phyllis, Dick, Jerry and Darlene, Eloise, Rob, Ruth, Gordon, Glenn and Veronica, Kristen, Joan, Peg, those on our extended prayer list, and those we mention either aloud or to ourselves. God of grace, God of all steadfastness, you set Christ as the cornerstone and foundation of the church. Build up this congregation as living stones, that it stands in the community as a witness to your enduring faithfulness and love. God of grace, God of all hope, the saints who came before us lived and died with their hearts fixed on you, especially Marie Winkleman. We give you thanks for their faithful witness, and we wait with hope for the great day when we join their voices in praise. God of grace. We pray, O God, that you join us this week in the celebration of the birthdays of Carl Storrs, Diane Eisenberg, and Darlene Sacco, the baptisms of Charlie Succo, Cynthia Laletta, Christine Lunardini, and the fifth anniversary of Scott and Christine Lunardini, the 42nd anniversary of Mike and Cindy Minnelli, and the 63rd anniversary of Jerry and Darlene Charlog. God, in your mercy.
Into your hands, O God, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
Let's share the peace with one another. Peace. Please remain seated.
Thank you.
Let us pray. Merciful God, as grains of wheat scattered upon the hills were gathered together to become one bread, so let your church be gathered together from the ends of the earth into your kingdom. For yours is the glory through Jesus Christ, now and forever. Amen. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places offer, give praise and give thanks and praise to you, Almighty and merciful God, through our Savior Jesus Christ, who on this day overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection open to us the way of everlasting life. And so with all the choirs of angels, with the church on earth, and the hosts of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, mighty, and merciful Lord, heaven and earth are full of your glory. In great love you sent to us Jesus, your Son, who reached out to heal the sick and suffering, who preached good news to the poor, and who on the cross opened his arms to all. In the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus took bread and gave thanks, broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat. This is my body given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." Again, after supper, he took the cup, and when he had given thanks, he blessed it and gave it to them, saying, "Drink of this, all of you. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, poured out for you and for all people for the forgiveness of sin. Do this for the remembrance of me." Remembering, therefore, his death, resurrection, and ascension, we await his coming in glory. Pour out upon us the spirit of your love, O Lord, and unite the wills of all who share this heavenly food, the body and blood of Jesus Christ our Lord, to whom with you and the Holy Spirit be all honor and glory, now and forever. Amen. Amen. We join in the prayer our Lord taught us.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Come and eat and drink the gifts of God for all the people of God. May this gift of the living body and blood of Christ strengthen us and keep us in God's grace. Amen.
Let us pray. Our God, our life, our strength, our food, we give you thanks for sustaining us with the body and blood of your Son. By your Holy Spirit, enliven us to be his body in the world, that more and more we will give you praise and serve your earth and its many peoples through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
Those who have announcements, please come forward. Several that I have, of course. Better get my notes. First of all, go ahead, Kurt.
We have 80 attendees.
80 people in worship today. And how many people on Zoom?
12.
12 households on Zoom. Good to be all together. It's wonderful. I have several announcements. One, thanks to everybody who helped with, participated, or brought a dog to the pet blessing yesterday. We had about a dozen pooches, maybe 15 or so, and they all got along with each other so well. A little snarl here and there, but it was really wonderful, and the weather cooperated so well. Again, thanks for your participation. Next, this coming Saturday is our harvest celebration. Several things are going to take place Saturday at 4 o'clock. We will be kind of putting the garden to bed for the winter and blessing it for its time of rest. I know there was a harvest yesterday. We're just shy of 600 pounds. Is there another green pepper out there? That I think we're gonna make the 600 pounds. We also, the pumpkins that our pumpkin patch produced, which are over there on the speaker, those will be used to decorate. Whether you're a child or just a child at heart, you're welcome to decorate a pumpkin to take home with you. We'll also be, this is still not absolutely set in concrete because it's subject to Harmon's availability, but we expect to dedicate the Dolores and Harmon butterfly garden as part of the celebration next Saturday. If you leave the building by the north entrance, you'll notice that the butterfly garden, even this late in the year, is just covered with flowers, and it's just beautiful. It's welcoming as we come in. It's I think inspiring as we go out, and it's also very attractive to the butterflies, and I can testify to that firsthand. So please come and be a part of the harvest celebration next week. On October 19th, that's the third Thursday, we will have this fellowship lunch, fellowship games, a trivia game this month. There's a sign-up sheet on a new red bulletin board that you can't miss. If you can, if you see it, please, and you're planning to be here, there's no age limit. You can be, there's like, if you're 1 year old or if you're 99 years old or anywhere in between there. We don't want anybody under one or over 99 yet. As soon as some of you get to be over 99, we'll raise that limit. But please know that you are welcome. The following Saturday, the 21st, is our sort and toss party. And we are looking to to just purge our various storage spaces around the church of stuff that we don't need and will never use again, and we don't need to keep storing. We, as many people as are able to be here on the 21st to help, will be going through basically room by room, seeing what storage is there, what's in there, what needs to be kept, whether it can be kept in a different place, with three congregations worshiping and doing fellowship in this building. We need to coordinate things a little bit better than when we were the solo folks in the building. So that's the purpose of the sort and toss party on the 21st. Bible studies this week, Wired Word at 1 o'clock by Zoom or in person. There's a little write-up on the subject. And then Wednesday night at 7 o'clock by Zoom only, we will continue our study of the book of Jonah. If you did not join us in the past and you'd like to, we've got three more weeks on Jonah. I don't know about those of you who were part of it, but I just love the conversation that we've had around Jonah, and I think it will be fun for it to continue, and we'd love to include others. With that, Terry. Thank you, Terry. I think Chris is right behind you. Thank you. Please exit as you are able by the west doors. We're not actually going to go outside. We just want to literally move people out of the sanctuary as if we were going out to the park. Then we're going to come back here for our final hymn. Hope you don't catch on fire. You can stay. You can stay. Yeah, that's fine. Okay. You all can come back in now. I think we have proved the point. Let's come back in for benediction and sending ourselves out. Thank you very much for your cooperation. It's important that we anticipate what we need to do, and of course one of the learnings from today is that we have people who need some additional assistance to be able to do that. You just don't pick up and run off. So we won't leave anyone behind, but we do want to be aware that various people have various needs, and we need to pay attention to that. Are there any other announcements? If not, I would invite you to stand for the benediction, and we'll send ourselves out in song. The Lord bless us and keep us. The Lord's face shine on us and be gracious to us. The Lord look upon us with favor and give us God's peace.